just crazy that we are now sat in a fuel cell car that you can buy and you can go fill it up with green hydrogen, and the only thing that comes out of the back is water.
I think hydrogen has great potential as a fuel for automobiles in the very near future.
For the past decades, everyone's been saying, oh, it's just around the corner, they're nearly there.
I believe that today's children will one day take their driver's test in a hydrogen-powered, pollution-free car.
I genuinely believe that this technology is going to be beneficial for us all. And because we are only on this rock for a very small amount of time, I want to make a difference. And I think the main way that I can do that is trying to get the electrification of the transport industry complete.
I'm an energy reporter for the Journal, and I've been hearing a lot about the promise of hydrogen as the energy source for the future.
As the global population and economy expand, the world's demand for energy is expected to grow dramatically in the next 30 years. So some are asking, could hydrogen, the most abundant element in the universe, help reduce the use of fossil fuels and boost the adoption of renewable energy? Some of the world's biggest companies believe in hydrogen's potential and have invested heavily. They're betting they can build a $2.5 trillion market around it.
But there's also skepticism around it. Will people embrace the hydrogen revolution? Or is it overhyped?
This isn't the first time scientists have been captivated by hydrogen's potential as a clean fuel source. In 1874, science fiction writer Jules Verne dreamed up a world where we could create fuel from water.
A roar and a burst of flame.
In the 1930s, we saw the promise and peril of the Hindenburg, the hydrogen-filled blimp that flew across the Atlantic and exploded, killing many on board. In the late 60s, hydrogen fuel cells helped power NASA's Apollo missions to the moon, while liquid hydrogen was used as a rocket fuel in other space ventures. And after the oil shocks of the 70s, some wondered if hydrogen could replace oil. Since then, technology has made great strides. So I wanted to understand, how exactly do we go from water to fuel? Dr. Whitley took me to his lab to show me how the whole process starts. Step one, create or capture the hydrogen.
The interesting thing about hydrogen is it's the most abundant element in the universe, which is great, but it's not naturally occurring on Earth. So it's always, as you say, it's tied up in other chemicals.
So how do we get it? How do you do it here?
The process in electrolysis, using the system that we're developing here, you put water in, apply some electricity to the system, and then you get hydrogen coming out and oxygen. We discard the oxygen to the atmosphere, and then we store the hydrogen.
Once that hydrogen is created, it can be used in three main ways. To store energy, generate heat, or in the case of hydrogen-powered cars, electricity. Look at this diagram created by Toyota. Hydrogen gas is stored in this tank. It flows through a stack of fuel cells, like this one, where it meets oxygen and creates electricity that powers the car. Hydrogen fuel cell cars are available in more than 20 countries, with brands like Toyota and Hyundai selling models for between $50,000 and $60,000 before government incentives.
So this is a representative example of what is in a car now. So Toyota's system, Honda systems, any automotive manufacturer system uses around 200 square centimeter membranes. So whereas the R&D that we do is on quite small ones because we don't want to waste materials, the real world application stuff is a lot bigger.
Over the last 5 to 10 years, fuel cells have gotten smaller, more efficient and cheaper to make, partly due to a reduction in the use of costly metals such as platinum. Now they pack a big punch. Hydrogen fuel cells could be especially useful for heavy trucks that need to travel long distances and require more energy than batteries are currently able to provide. They're already being used to power everything from cars, drones, and trains. Some entrepreneurs think there's money to be made.
My name's Adam Bond. I'm the chief executive at AFC Energy. We're a UK-listed company over the last 13 or so years, and our business is really in the development of hydrogen fuel cells. So through here we have the fuel cell system. At its core are our two fuel cell stacks, which are both hidden behind those blue end plates.
His idea is that hydrogen can be used to charge electric vehicles. The number of hydrogen-powered passenger cars on the road doesn't even come close to battery electric vehicles and plug-in hybrids. And all those batteries need to be charged.
What we've done is basically said, well, if you're not going to have a hydrogen car, you're probably going to have an electric car, and so that needs to be charged from a decarbonized source as well, and that's where our fuel cell comes into play.
How much would I pay for something like that?
Something like that, you're probably looking at somewhere around the $100,000 mark.
When we went to AFC, Adam said they were in talks with potential buyers like car park owners and shopping centers, but hadn't made any sales yet. So how are they able to do their work? Well, AFC has received government funding in the past, and in the 2019 financial year, they raised roughly $7 million in equity and bonds. UCL currently relies on a mix of government funding and private investment, and interest from businesses around the world is on the rise. More than 80 companies so far have joined an initiative called the Hydrogen Council, which aims to make hydrogen a key part of the energy transition. In 2017, its members invested about $1.5 billion in hydrogen and fuel cells, and the group says it expects the number to rise in coming years.
But here's the thing. For many of those companies, hydrogen is still just going to be a sliver of their business. More importantly, there's some pretty big obstacles to taking hydrogen mainstream. Producing the gas is still expensive because it's not manufactured at scale. And while hydrogen fuel cell technology works in labs, cars, and refueling stations being deployed primarily in Japan and Asia, the infrastructure isn't there in the rest of the world yet. Here in London, the nearest hydrogen refueling station is about 45 minutes away.
This is what they were saying about the freezer.
So as you can see, there's a lot of frost on the outside of the nozzle. And that's because the gas is chilled so much inside the machine that it can temporarily freeze to the car, but it just comes off with a yank. Yeah.
Though the price is expected to go down, hydrogen fuel is comparable to the cost per mile for gasoline in the UK, but more expensive than charging an electric vehicle. And history shows that major energy transitions like this take a long time. It took more than 100 years for countries like the US, Germany, or China to move away from burning wood and primarily relying on coal and other fossil fuels, according to some experts.
Not to mention that most of the hydrogen that we produce today is not produced through a clean process.
Hydrogen is used in many industrial processes, like the production of steel, special metals, and fertilizers. In those cases, hydrogen is typically made using fossil fuels. But scientists say that hydrogen can be created without releasing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere by using renewable energy through the electrolysis process. Despite all the obstacles, the International Energy Agency says hydrogen projects span a growing number of industries, more countries are involved, and it's seen as something that can accelerate the adoption of renewable energy. And some scientists think hydrogen might be about to change the way we power the world.
There's this running joke within the fuel cell community that we're always a couple of years away from mass commercialization, and I heard that when I started my PhD, and now a few years later we're still saying that. But I think now, the state of the technology right now and the way the industry is, I think we are now definitely on the verge of the mass commercialization of this kind of technology.